I am so fired up, amped up, revved up, and it's not because I had a cup of coffee. You drank it all again. I went out. How many of you had a cup of coffee? Let me see your hands. Good. You better stay awake during my sermon today. I went out there, maybe 15, 20 minutes ago to get a cup of coffee, and it was gone. So I shall be sustained, most importantly, by the Spirit of Almighty God. I am so psyched about this morning. Let's give a little bit of good news first. How many of you want some good news? So the good news is that no matter how dark things look, God is still in control. There's a cowardly nation over in the Middle East. Its modern day name is Iran. Its old biblical name is Persia. Iran, in a cowardly fashion, launched an attack on God's chosen people here recently. How many of you are aware of that? How many of you understand that? Be not deceived, God is not mocked. And bottom line is, you can't touch God's chosen people unless God allows it. And in spite of that, what's going on over there? And you know, we tend to, in the human realm, what do? We tend to get all nervous and we get agitated, particularly because many of us believe that the one occupying the White House is absolutely not a deterrent to war. We believe, in fact, that his very presence incites war and division over in the Middle East. If you believe that, let me see your hand. Hands are going up all over. Whether you agree with that or not, here's what we must all agree with as Christians. No matter how dark things get, no matter how chaotic, no matter how much war stirs up around us, God is in control. And Christians, it just means the time of Christ's return is drawing that much closer. Amen? That's some good news. So this morning's message, we are going to continue our sermon series in the book of Colossians. Let's go ahead and hold our Bibles up, do our biblical affirmation. Let's say it like we mean it. I believe the Bible is God's word. Inerrant, infallible, inspired, authoritative, relevant. I will, by God's grace, obey it and apply it to my life today. Amen and amen. Hey, one more bit of good news. My word, yesterday we had our men's prayer breakfast, skeet shooting, pistol target practice, and somewhere between 70 and 80 men showed up. If you were one of the men that were here yesterday, raise your hand up high. We love you, men. We thank God for you. You guys are so faithful. I had the privilege of sharing Christ with several of the guests you brought to the men's prayer breakfast, folks that did not know the Lord Jesus Christ. And they were attracted to the fact that there's a church that has a gun range. I'm so glad that you don't edit those things out. Thank you for never editing my comments. If I ever think maybe you need to, I'll get with those of you that do that, uploading of that on YouTube and Rumble and all of that. But all right, let's do this. Let's move in the reality of understanding that Jesus Christ is the beginning and the end. He's the Alpha and the Omega. It starts with him. It will end with him. Anything that we have going on good is because of him. And the message today is all about him. And the focus is on Jesus Christ, the head of this church and every true church. You know, when Christ has first place, like we're instructed in the book of Colossians, it changes everything. It brings about, truly brings about, life transformation. Open your Bibles up to the book of Colossians, New Testament book, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, and then Colossians. And we are in chapter 1. Last week we looked at my prayer for you and for me. And this week we look at He alone is worthy. Christ alone is worthy. Verses 13 through 29 is our text for today. Let me go ahead and make a decision now up front. I do not want to rush this material about our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I want to go as deep as I need to go talking about Jesus Christ. And so this is part one. Y'all didn't hear that, but on the front row, this bashful man said, so there's going to be a part four? I don't think so, but we could have an unlimited number of parts and never cover the fullness, the richness, the omnipotence, the omnipresence, the awesomeness of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. But I'm going to plan on doing this message in two parts. So today, we're going to look at really those first few verses of Colossians 1, 13 through 29. Would you get your notes out, but most importantly, get your Bibles out. Hopefully, you have your place turned to the book of Colossians. I did not turn there in my Bible, so I better get there. Colossians chapter 1. Everybody follow along if you would. Verse 13. For he, capital H, he rescued us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Wow! In those two verses, just wow! Just starting off hardcore, Apostle Paul, man alive. You are hitting us with this reality that first and foremost, Christian, he has rescued you. He has rescued us from the domain of darkness, and he has transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son. I need us to understand something. We are a church filled with love, 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 and truth, truth, truth. There's a couple here today, and as they came in, they said, we're here. Essentially, what they said was, we're here because we're tired of getting our ears tickled at another church. And I tell you right now, there is a remnant. There are Christians who are starving to death spiritually because they are in woke churches. They're in churches that are talking and more concerned about so-called social justice and wokeism and DEI than they're concerned about proclaiming the whole counsel of God, where we discover what real justice is. Amen? And people are fleeing those crazy Laodicean churches, and praise God, many are coming here. And the church here is growing with two tracts of people, I believe. One tract are unbelievers, people that don't know the Lord Jesus Christ yet as their Savior and Lord. That group of people are coming to Jesus Christ in record numbers right here at this church. You know why, church family? Because you're inviting them. You're telling your friends, your relatives, your associates, and neighbors about Jesus Christ, and you're saying, come to my church. Man, you will feel the love of Christ there. You and I know they will hear the truth of Jesus Christ here at this church. Every Sunday, there are people putting their faith in Christ. Unbelievable. I think the last three Sundays, we baptized every Sunday. Glory to God. That's what we want. I need us to understand, though, is Jesus Christ, Christian, rescued you from the domain of darkness and transferred you and me. He transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, Jesus Christ. We need to see lost people as hostages to Satan and to darkness. This is so critical. Quite a few years ago, a TV show came on, and my wife and I don't watch much TV at all. There's not much worth watching. We don't have cable. We don't have satellite. We've chosen just to never do that nonsense. Some of you have 500 and some odd channels, and you just sit there and you surf through, and there's nothing really good and redemptive on, right? Well, we were watching maybe 15, 20 years ago some movie with that character Mel Gibson, and it was called Ransom. How many of you saw that? Yeah, there you go. I was glued to the TV screen because I'm telling you right now, I'm a daddy bear and I love my kids, and now I love my grandson, and I love my kids. Well, the movie was about these evil people kidnapping Mel Gibson's son, trying to get money. And it was nightmarish. And I remember sitting on the edge of the seat, and I was just watching. I'm thinking, how is he gonna get his son back? And I'm thinking, man, just go crazy on those terroristic, you know, kidnappers. And in the end, for those of you who didn't see the movie, praise God, the boy was rescued, amen? Well, let me just tell you something. Christ has rescued us from the domain of darkness, and it's critical that we see people that don't know Christ as needing to be rescued in the name of Jesus. Now, this is really important. It's extremely important. Otherwise, we get filled with anger and with hate, and it's not righteous. Now, there's a righteous anger, amen? It's the righteous anger that Jesus had when he made a whip and he went into the temple and he drove out the money changers and overturned the tables, money flying everywhere. And he said, my house will be a house of prayer, but you've made it a den of thieves. That was righteous anger. Amen. There is a righteous anger. You know how we can express it? One young lady, I won't mention her name, but her initials are Connie. She came up to me before the service and she said, make sure and let everybody know. Remember, you're always preaching about us being salt and being light. And so, man, they need to get out, you know, and there's runoffs and there's this and that. We got to get informed. We got to get people informed. We got to be salt and light. It's a time to express your righteous anger when we come around to election time. Even if it's a runoff, even if it's an upcoming presidential election, there's a time to express your righteous anger. We're going to vote them rascals out. You're out of here. This is a personal statement. You stole the first election, but you're not getting away with it again. Did you hear me make a distinction? All right, where are we going? There's going to be a part three, right? No, I'm just kidding. There's not. Part two, that's it. He rescued us, but we got to see people the way Jesus sees people. We got to stop looking at people according to the flesh. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 16. Please write that in your notes. Go back and study that beautiful passage. 2 Corinthians 5, 16. It says we got to stop seeing people according to the flesh. The people, Paul writing it said, we saw Jesus according to the flesh. But after they were saved, they were rescued from the domain of darkness. They no longer saw Jesus. from the point of view of the flesh. So, in the past, I mean, just a month or so ago, I had images up there about those people enslaved to darkness. And I showed an image of the assistant secretary to Health and Human Services Director. And I said this statement, and I meant it, I stand by it. Folks, we gotta have pity on a man that plays dress up every day when he goes to work. And I'm serious about that. And we gotta love people enough to, with God's power, with Christ's power, to rescue them from the domain of darkness. We need to rescue them, right? Because our enemy, as we learned in our spiritual warfare series, is it's not people, it's not flesh and blood, it's Satan and it's his demons. So we gotta stop looking at people according to the flesh, or we get unholy anger. We wanna have righteous anger. We don't wanna have unholy anger. So that first point there in that verse, it's so beautiful. He rescued us from the domain of darkness. And we need to think about it. We need to see them the way Christ sees them. Not according to the flesh. All right, he redeemed us. Do you see it right there? And so he rescued us from the domain of darkness. And then verse 14, in whom we have, what's that next word? That was weak. In verse 14, in whom we have redemption. So, a couple of weeks ago, a family that you just can't help but love. How many of you have fallen in love with the Marble family over here? They always sit over here. They jump, they shout. They gave me this shirt, and it says redeemed on the vertical post of the cross. On the front side, there's a cross, and you know, it's got the spikes. The rusty spikes that were used to crucify our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I declare to you, Jesus Christ has redeemed us. Ready? Literally, he's bought us back. He's bought us back. And think about it for a moment. When we think about redemption, the metaphor that Paul uses back in Romans is this idea of a slave block. And so 100% of humanity is enslaved to Satan and to sin without Christ. If you agree with that, say amen. 100%. We all get the whole age of accountability, don't we? Don't we understand? When a little baby, passes... as King David said in the Old Testament, when he lost his precious son, he said, I will see you again one day. So for all of you that have lost a precious little baby through a miscarriage, or if you've lost a child through SIDS or whatever, here's the bottom line. We know those little beautiful creatures are below the age of accountability. We get that. But understand this, all of us are under the domain of darkness. All of us are slaves before Christ to Satan and to sin. So we got to see people the way Christ sees them. You want to know why pornography is an epidemic in our nation right now? It's so many do not know, they've not experienced being bought back off of the slave block. Now there are some that have been bought back and they allow themselves to be sucked in. But redeemed brothers and sisters, you don't have to be sucked back in because you have the power, ready, to say no. If you believe that, say amen. So redeemed is being bought back. Jesus Christ, when he died on the cross, he bought us back with what? His precious blood. His precious blood. Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sins, we find. And that's what the whole animal sacrifices was all about in the Old Testament, right? It was symbolic. But that precious, innocent lamb that was taken in that was taken into a home to remember, to memorialize, remember, Passover. That sacred lamb was symbolic, that lamb without blemish was symbolic of the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, who was, his blood was shed for you and me to buy us back, to redeem us off the slave block. And then look at that next one. Redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Christ forgave us. Come on, church family. Come on. Sometimes we just get so spiritually apathetic, and we just need to be reminded we are forgiven. Amen. All of our sins, past, present, and future, we are forgiven by Jesus Christ, who alone is worthy of our praise. Sometimes I just get busy. I'm a pastor, but I get busy, and I just need to remind myself. I can even be in the middle of telling people the gospel. Sometimes I just need to remind myself, Jeff, you have been rescued from the domain of darkness. Jeff, you have been bought back. You've been redeemed off the slave block of sin and Satan. And Jeff, you've been forgiven. How many of you know, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that you've been rescued, you've been redeemed, you've been forgiven by Christ? Oh, hang on to that. Hang on to that. And let me explain something to you. No amount of hanging on your part, ready, can keep you saved. Guess what? The one that has rescued you and redeemed you and forgiven you, and he did all of this not based on any of your works or my works, guess what? He's the one that will never let go of you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. I don't care what you're going through. There's things each of us bear and we don't share. We may share a lot in our life groups when prayer time goes around. But there's things that each of us have that we don't share, right? It's stuff we have in here, and we bring it to the Lord. But understand this, the cross of Christ provides rescuing and redemption and forgiveness. And there is nothing that can separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Someone in this church that prayed to receive Christ a while back said to me, I need you to talk to me. I'm feeling like I've lost my salvation. And I looked at this man and I said, friend, you can never lose your salvation. Once it's truly yours by faith, by grace, apart from works, you can't lose it. You're eternally secure based on Christ. Christ's power, not your power. And shared some scripture with him. John 10:28, I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall anyone pluck them out of my hand. You're eternally secure if you're born again. Please, please don't run around feeling like you're saved one day, you're lost the next, just because you had an impure thought or you blew it. No, just put it under the blood of Christ. 1 John 1:9, I like calling it the Christian bar of soap. I got a clean fetish going on. I just got to let you know. Angela, thanks God for that. Some of you husbands need to get a little bit more of a clean fetish. I shower at least twice a day. Yeah, twice a day. I love the old-fashioned soap where you can really lather up. Anybody else like that? If you don't raise your hand. 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. 1 John 1:9, the Christian's bar of soap. All right, look at that next point in your notes. He is God. He is God. Look at verse 15. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For it was the Father's good pleasure for all the fullness to dwell in him. He is God. Jesus is God. In the incarnation, he didn't lose his godness. He was 100% God and 100% man. He is God. I've got a picture that I have in my office. It's of my beautiful bride, Angela. And then I've got another picture I love having in my office. And it's a picture of my son, John, and my daughter, Kristen. And then, you know, if you stop and think about another type of image is the painted portrait. When I was 11 years old, my dad got the idea of selling a health spa membership, trading it for some famous artist to do portraits of the family and to do a painting of each member of the family. So it's debatable if you ever see that painted portrait of me in my sunroom. It's debatable that she was a talented artist that did it, that painted it. It was hideous. My brother got a haircut, and I just wanted to look up to my older brother, so I took some scissors and I cut kind of a jagged chunk out of my bangs, and the artist painted that chunk, forever immortalized, out of my hair. Angela walks in the sunroom, and she's going to spend time with the Lord, and before she does that, she looks up at her 11-year-old version of her husband, and she's like so impressed. I said, please burn it, throw it away. It is no likeness to me, your husband. She won't. She leaves it up there to gently torture me. It is an image, though. A portrait, a painting, is another type of image. Another type of image is electronic. So on my phone, just, you know, in case you're interested after the service, I've got 687 pictures and videos of my grandson. Hold on a second. Y'all bear with me for a second. Is he sleeping? Oh. I don't know. Have y'all met my grandson? If you've met my grandson, raise your hand. The rest of you are underprivileged. Okay, he's here right now, and I will not wake him. The parents, thank me. All right, wouldn't it be silly, though, if my grandson's right there with me, and I'm sitting there looking at electronic images of my grandson on the phone when my grandson's right there in front of me, right? Because the electronic image, although it's kind of cool and we can watch these videos over and over again, when the person's there, it'd be like me sitting there in front of my wife and I'm sitting and she's right in front of me, drop dead gorgeous, godly, incredibly intelligent woman. And she's in front of me, and I'm just sitting here staring at her photograph. It'd be silly, because this is not an exact representation of my wife. Neither is this an exact representation of my son or my daughter, or the electronic version of it. Or another type of image would be a statue. I don't have any statues made of me. How many of you have statues made in your image? Oh, my word, if you raise your hand. Where's our head of prayer counselors back there? Steve Clark, if you see any hands go up, activate your prayer counselors. They need help. Look, if somebody made a statue of your image, it wouldn't be a perfect match. Man, I just heard a wife over here. She looked at her husband and she said, the closest statue that would represent you would be the statue of David. Oh. Thank you. Soon to be married, the engaged ones right here, Desiree and Michael, amen. It's romantic, but where are we? Another image is a coin. You take a coin out of your pocket and you look, and on some coins there's an image of a person. And so it's flawed, though. But everybody look with me. Verse 19, For it was the Father's good pleasure for how much of the fullness to dwell in Christ, in him. You understand, Christ is the exact image and representation of God because he is God. He's perfect. He's not some cheap copy. He's not like a partially fitting image. He's the perfect, exact image and representation of God. Why? Because he is God. If you want to know, how many of you have people come knock on your door and they ride up on bicycles? Anybody ever had that happen? They knock. What you want to do, if you want to find it, if they're a cult, two really quick discerning questions you can ask. Ask them, is Jesus Christ God? In other words, he's God, has he always existed as God? Center around questions about Christ's deity, right? If it's a cult, they get it wrong every time, right? And the other question that you can do is, with those people that come up to your door, whether they're on a bicycle or they're whatever, it doesn't matter, whether they're a cult, is what do they do with the Word of God? Do they take away from it? Or do they add to it? Oh, well, yeah, we believe the Bible, but you've got to have this book of, and you've got to have this pearl of. You see where I'm coming? I hope I'm not offending anybody. But that's how you discern a cult. And Jesus Christ is the Word, right? It's the expression from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So what do they do with Jesus? If they minimize his godness, his deity, run, get away from him. This message, this book, is all about Jesus Christ, his awesomeness, the fact that he is God. All right, turn the page in your notes. He is the image of the invisible God, verse 15. But look at that next series of words, one in particular. He's the firstborn of all creation. Does everybody see it? He's the firstborn of all creation. He has the most important place, like a firstborn son had, in that Middle Eastern culture. The context in which Paul was writing was, if you were a firstborn son, you had a position of prominence. You actually got a greater portion of inheritance. You were the cat's meow if you were the firstborn son. So Jesus Christ is over all creation. He is creator of all things. Let's back up for a moment. Let that sink in. Genesis 1. In the beginning, God created the... Right. Okay. You look at Genesis 1 and you've got God the Father going on there in that creative act. You've got God the Holy Spirit. Remember, the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. We find recorded, write this in your notes, please. You could spend months studying what I'm getting ready to tell you. Write these references. Genesis 1, John chapter 1, Hebrews chapter 1. Ready? Revelation chapter 1. In other words, listen, God made it simple for us. He put it in those first chapters of those books. But basically, what is he saying? He's saying he's over all creation. In verse 16, he's the creator of all things. Look at verse 16. For by him, all things were created, both in heavens and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authority. All things have been created through him and for him. Brothers and sisters, listen to this. We know that in the beginning, John 1, was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then you go down a verse, and basically you find that nothing was made that wasn't made by Jesus. He created everything. That's why the key to spiritual warfare and winning it, look at reference Ephesians chapter 6. Verses 10 through 18. The key to winning our battle against Satan and his demons as we saw, put on the whole armor of God. You can take each piece of the spiritual armor, and guess what? You can find a scripture that's actually a reference to Jesus Christ. Breastplate of righteousness. He is our righteousness. The sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. He is the Word. You can just go through each piece. And it's Jesus, it's Jesus, it's Jesus. We win spiritual warfare by putting on Jesus. How many of you believe that? How many of you are really glad that are staying for the fun day for youth and the fun day for children and kickball and dodgeball and all of that, that this is a two-parter and I'm not going to go for another hour? I'm glad you didn't say amen too loudly. There's a lot more to share about God being the creator of all things. We're going to put a comma there until next Sunday. I want to move us into a time of invitation. We do this every week. We don't want there to be a time that we open up the doors to the church and people come in. We don't want to ever have a time where we don't make clear how a person can have a relationship with God. It is pure and simple through Jesus Christ. It is, you ready? It's accepting God's way above your own way. So watch this. I can't have a relationship with God, my creator, unless I go through his son, the God-man Jesus. There's no other name given among men whereby we must be saved. And what is that name, church family? The name is Jesus. There's no other name than Jesus. And so what I want to encourage you this morning is to, in this moment, and I'm this is probably the most critical part of the service. And so please take just 60 to 90 seconds with me and stay right there in your seats and hear the gospel. God loves you. God sent his son, Jesus Christ, to be born of the Blessed Virgin Mary. God, I'm sure asked his son, are you willing to do this? Because you're going to need to suffer and die on the cross to pay for the sins of the world. And Jesus willingly gave up the riches of heaven, took on the rags of humanity. He lived a perfect life. And in that perfect life, he earned the right to pay for your sins and my sins and the sins of the world. So when he hung on that cross, he was beaten. He suffered for you and me. When he hung on that cross, his blood was shed. He died. Because the wages of our sin is death. It's spiritual separation from God. He paid the penalty for our sin. He paid the penalty for everyone's sin. But it's only applied to those of us that believe, to those of us that trust Jesus Christ to take away our sin and to give us eternal life. So the message of Christianity is a message of substitution. He took your place. He took my place. You say, how can I become a Christian, a true Christian? How can I have my sins forgiven? How can I know when I die I'll go to heaven? Well, listen, this is it. The Bible says whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. Just put it in your own words, but call on the name of the Lord Jesus. Maybe say something like this. With bowed head and closed eyes, maybe say something like this. Call it a prayer of faith or call it whatever you want, but say something like this to God. If you want your sins forgiven, if you want to have eternal life, say something like this. Lord Jesus, I know I've sinned, and I know my sin separates me from you. Right now, I ask you to take away my sin and to give me eternal life. Jesus, I'm trusting in you alone. You are my Lord and my Savior. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. Thank you, Jesus, for rescuing me from the domain of darkness, for buying me back from sin and Satan. Thank you for forgiving me. With heads bowed and eyes closed, if you just prayed that prayer of faith, you called on Jesus and you meant it to forgive you of your sins and give you eternal life. If you did that sincerely this morning, heads bowed, eyes closed. Would you slip your hand up right now, please? Raise your hand if you just prayed that prayer. God bless you. Is there someone else? God bless you and you. Are there others? Thank you, Lord, for these who've indicated with uplifted hand, receiving you for the forgiveness of sins and for eternal life. Christians, we live in dark times, but Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, stands ready. Just as he rescued you and me from the domain of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son, he stands ready to use us as instruments to bring rescue and reconciliation to others who are still in the domain of darkness. Some of you maybe know of a friend that doesn't know Jesus. Maybe they're a family member and they don't know Jesus. Maybe it's someone you work with, maybe it's a neighbor, but they don't know Jesus, and you want to see them rescued from the domain of darkness. I'm gonna encourage you, Christian. Listen, I know you can pray wherever you are. You could stay home and pray. But God's called us to come together. My house shall be a house of prayer. We're gonna open the altar up for a time of prayer. There'll be prayer counselors down front. If you prayed to receive Christ and you'd like to visit with a prayer counselor, we want you to do that. Prayer counselors, if you'd make your way down front right now. But for Christians, maybe just to come and kneel or stand and pray for someone you know that needs the Lord. Do you believe prayer is important? Come. Wow, people are moving forward right now. Just let's go ahead and stand to our feet to make it easier for people to get out and around. But come to the altar and just give it to the Lord and say, Lord, I want to be used more fully by you. And pray for that family member. Pray for that neighbor. Maybe that person you work with. You come forward right now and kneel or stand and lift it up to the Lord. Amen and amen. There's room for you if you want to come forward. There'll be a prayer counselor that will agree with you. If you want somebody to agree with you for the salvation of a loved one, a friend, you come forward. They'll pray with you. They'll pray for that lost family member, that lost coworker. Lord Jesus, hear the cries of our hearts, humbly presented to you for many different things, Lord, but I think a lot of what's going on right now is crying out to you on behalf of unsaved friends and relatives, maybe people we work with. Hear our prayer, our prayers, O God, and bring about faith in the hearts of men and women and young people that are being prayed for, Lord. We promise to give you all the glory and the honor and the praise for what you're going to do. Thank you for ordaining prayer as a powerful spiritual warfare weapon to fight back Satan, the God of this age, small g, that has blinded the eyes of them that are perishing. Continue, Lord God, to move in the midst of those that are near and dear to us for their true salvation. Continue to grow us as a church spiritually and numerically. It's in the peerless and the matchless name of Jesus that we pray. And all God's people said, amen and amen. I want to invite us now, go ahead and be seated. Let's continue worshiping the Lord with tithes and offerings. A guest, would you please put your connection cards in the offering basket so I can get some information out to you.
All right, by show of hands, or maybe even applause, who is glad they came to church today? That's what I'm talking about. All right. Amen. I've got some important announcements, and most of them are around one thing, and that is today is Family Fun Day. If you haven't noticed, there's balloons over here. Yeah, that's right. You can applause that. That's very good stuff. So, hey, the balloons have a purpose. They're going to have a launch later, I think. I think it's like a counter-terrorist balloon launch, something like that. We'll do something to that effect out when we celebrate the opening of the playground. So, a couple of important notes here. If you forgot or didn't bring a potluck dish, no worries. Our youth and children leadership cooked extra. We've got extra food. So if you didn't plan on staying, please just stay and enjoy some food and fellowship and fun. We're going to line up after the service releases and get our food to the main kitchen, and the children's ministry and families will go across the way and eat in there, and the youth will eat in here, which also means that Chris Slaughter and a bunch of young men are going to have to clear all these chairs out, because they're going to be playing games in here afterwards. The youth are going to be in here playing a bunch of games, and the kids are going to be over across the way. The sun just came out, in case you couldn't tell, because it's to your back right now. It's going to be an amazing afternoon, so please hang around for a while. Again, even if you don't have families or kids directly participating, it's going to be a great one church day to spend together, so please do that. And with that said, would you all stand as I dismiss us in a word of prayer? Dear Lord, we thank you for this place. We thank you for your son. We thank you for your word and the amazing messages that you put on our pastor's heart, Lord. May we take them seriously. May we remember we are saved. We are forgiven. May we never take that for granted in the daily rush and the daily whatever. Lord, let us take those moments and just look up and say thank you. Just thank you, thank you, thank you, Jesus, for what you did on the cross. Let us be bold in our faith and sharing our hearts with others, no matter who we run into, family, friends, co-workers, people at the gas station. Lord, may we just shine with the joy of the Lord in our hearts and on our countenance. In Jesus' name, we pray. And all God's people said, amen. You're dismissed, and the food is there.